Hey, this is Stacy Hayes. I'm glad you decided to listen to The Prodigal Son. I spent over a decade thinking God was mad at me and he was some bipolar old man sitting on his throne with a lightning bolt in one hand and the hammer in the other just waiting for me to mess up. That's not God. That's religion. God loves every one of us no matter where we're at in life, and he's waiting to see us coming to him like the prodigal son did in Luke 15:11-24. Read it. You'll be glad you did. Believe what God's word says about you over any opinion you have of yourself and watch God work a miracle in your life. Now let's see what the word of God has to say today. Father, I thank you, God, for this opportunity to teach your word. Lord, I praise you for the truth in your word. Lord, I praise you for all you're doing in this podcast. And I pray that you'd open people's hearts and lives to your word. Not to me, but to your word, Lord Jesus. Lord, I thank you and I praise you for all you've done, all you're doing in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, I talked about God being good last week, and he's compassionate and merciful. But, you know, the Lord led me to look at something last week after the podcast. And you know, I think I need to talk about this because I've got a question. And I think a lot of people don't really realize who their faith is in or what their faith is in. A Christian life is not what you believe as much as who you believe or who you believe in. And the 11th chapter of Mark, the 22nd verse, Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. You know, I lived a lot of years in my early 20s having faith in, well, really not having much faith at all, but what I did have confidence in is, you know, just how, I guess, the motions that I went through and the what it, you know, going to church and being there every time there was a service. And that's good. Don't get me wrong. I think we all, the Bible says, to fail not to assemble ourselves together. But I think that gets mixed up with what a true relationship with God is. And that's a personal, one-on-one relationship. Hey, I've come to the conclusion it doesn't matter what the people I go to church with, what their opinions are of my Christian life. It's what God's opinion is of my Christian life. And we've gotten to the point of a lot of people, good people, have gotten mixed up and misunderstand what God really wants us to know is our faith should be in him, not an organization. Now, don't go out and say Stacy said not to go to church, because that'd be a lie. Fail not to assemble yourself together. But let me clarify, you need to find a church that the word is number one. God's word over and above anything. I heard a man talk about this one time. He said, before I take up an offering, before we sing a song, he said, if anything has to be done away with, everything will be done away with before God's word. Because God's word is what we're going to live by. Like I say, it's hard not to sound harsh, but when you go to church and everything is you have to do all the little points And they all have to be done, and whatever time left else is left at the end of the service, we'll give the minister time enough to say a few words. That's your priorities are wrong. And if you're making decisions in your life on traditions or what the majority thinks, you're in bad shape as far as a Christian life, because it doesn't matter what everybody thinks. Now, don't get me wrong. Don't get out here in left field and go to, you know, thinking you're, you know, bulletproof and just, you know, the devil will deceive you and things like that. But when it comes right down to it, who do you have faith in? What is your faith in? Who do you believe in? That just kept coming up in me. And that Mark 11:22, you know, have faith in God. Now, it's good to have faith in your church as far as it being a good church. But I'll be honest with you. There's a multitude, millions of people in the world that we live in today have more faith in General Motors stock than they have in God. And that's sad. That's sad. But you know, you just take it for instance. If you had a service and some man the church or the service that you were in, you knew real well, and they stood up in the service and got up in front of you and said, "Look here, we've got a business opportunity to come about, and we're going to promise you, you know, 10 times a return on your money if you buy this stock." Well, that's well and good, but a lot of people, now, get this, understand this. A lot of people would believe that right there, but you go and tell them, and I'm going to read on down into the 23rd verse of the 11th chapter of Mark. You read on down and start talking to them about believing God and believe in what they say, and see if they would believe God's word, what he says, as strongly as they would believe some, you know, multinational company that's telling them that this stock that they're trying to sell them is going to go, you know, go through the roof. But the 23rd verse of Mark 11 says, "For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain," now he first said in the 22nd verse, says, "have faith in God." But if you have faith in God, then he tells you to go on down and really start speaking to that mountain. And those mountains are problems in your life. He says, "Be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith." And he goes on the 24th verse, says, "Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them." Now, that's God's word. Just as much as John 3:16 is, that's God's word. Just as much as Romans 10:9-10 is, that's God's word. And if you'll read Romans 10:9-10 and compare it with Mark 11:23-24, there's no difference. He says, "Believe in your heart, confess it with your mouth, and you'll have it." Romans 10:9-10 says, "Believe it in your heart, confess it with your mouth, and you'll be saved." So I'm asking you today, who do you have faith in? What do you have faith in? Do you have faith in a large corporation that's been, you know, it's 200 years old? As much as you, do you have more faith in that company than you do of God that created the world, put the solar systems in place? See, it's hard. You know, I never looked at that, but I don't know that people really believe that God loves them that much. And is that truthful? People doubt. You know, I talked about Thomas. And you know, if there's any one of the disciples or any of the disciples, you know, they watched Jesus Christ do miraculous things. And yet, when it came time to believe that he was resurrected, Thomas said, "I'll not believe it till I see it." And that's something that, my goodness, that's something that, you know, I don't understand it, because if I had seen the miracles that they had seen, I don't think I would have the problem that Thomas had. I just honestly can't see having that problem. But yet, we live in a world that is so carnally minded, and to be carnally minded is death. But we live in a world that's so carnally minded that they can't see God in just the sun rising and setting. Now, that's a miracle in itself. How does all this stay together? How does all of this work the way it's supposed to? God has to be holding it together, because I promise you, this the human body itself works flawlessly. And how that a child can be born and people, you know, a C-section, I really didn't understand it, but still really don't understand it, but my second child was born in C-section, and I didn't watch it. You know, I stayed away from the whole situation. I'm just not that interested. But they say that they pull everything inside of you out, get that kid out, and then they stuff it all back in, and somehow it all winds up and goes back to working the way it's supposed to. Now, if God ain't in that, I just don't understand how people can doubt that. But then again, I don't see how Thomas watched Jesus do all the miraculous things that he done and still stand and say, I won't believe it until I see it. And Christ called him faithless. Faithless. After all that he had seen, Jesus said he was faithless. And there again, who do you have your faith in? Do you have it in your goodness? Or God? I'm proclaiming to you today, have faith in God. Have faith in Him, in His goodness, and in what He wants to do for you. You know, I heard a preacher here, I think it was yesterday, he said, the majority of people do not believe that God loves them. And I myself can't see that. I can't believe that, because I know God loves me. But then again, there's so much doubt and unbelief in the world today, I tend to agree that majority of people don't know, don't believe that God loves them. And why is that? Well, it all boils down to faith. And I'm going to go read something, and this is completely off the message, but I feel like that I need to clarify this. And it's in the 11th chapter of Hebrews. It's really not off the message, but let me back up here and find it. Starting with the first verse. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So faith is what I'm going to hold on to while the manifestation of what I'm believing has not taken place yet. That's the essence of it. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of what I'm believing for will come to pass. But you go on down to the sixth verse. Now, this is where the rubber meets the road. It says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. Who is him? Please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You know, another translation talks about that, said believes that God exists. And that's a good translation, there's a lot of people that believe that God exists, but they've got a skewed way of looking at him. They've got an idea of God, and I've said it over and over again that he's some bipolar old man waiting to just smack them when they get out of line. And that's not the God that I'm telling you about. That's not my Lord and Savior. That's not my Father. Like I've said over and over again, this podcast is called The Prodigal Son for a reason. And the 11th or the 15th chapter of Luke talks about it. That young man came home to be a hired servant. He was prepared to be a hired servant just to survive. But the father wouldn't have it. You know, I know a lot of people that listen to this podcast probably don't have kids. But I have two children that I love dearly. And if you don't have kids, you won't understand what I'm talking about until you have one of your own. But as much as I love my kids, I still can't put it into words of how much I really know God loves me, far more than I love my kids. And that's hard to put together in my human mind, but that's just it. But the last part of that sixth verse is, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Now we've got to understand that word diligently. That's nothing to, you know, you're not just going to walk out in the front yard and say, well, I sought God today. Diligently seeking something is digging, looking, searching out, finding. And he's not hard to find. The Bible's full of God. It is God. You know, John talks about it being Jesus was the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's Jesus Christ. And all you to find God, to diligently look and find God, is to get up, open your Bible up, and seek him. To seek his word. To seek his will, which is his word. And when you do that, you're opening the door for God to not only bless you, but to strengthen you and guide you. How? Through his word, through the Holy Spirit guiding you through his word. And you want to you say, well, I don't have faith. I have, you know, very little faith, if any. Well, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Now, this podcast is only once a week, but there are, oh, so many good teachers that teach the Word. You know, the purpose of this podcast is to point you to God's Word, point you to the love of God, and to know that God loves you regardless of what this world has strapped on your back and told you that, you know, that you're too bad to ever find God. That's a lie. But if you want to find, if you want faith, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Now, if you want that in your life, seek that out. Let God guide you and lead you in the direction that you're supposed to go. Find you a church that teaches the Word, teaches faith, teaches that God's bigger than anything in this world that could ever come against you, and you'll find strength and faith being taught. I've come to the conclusion that I can. I mean, I've looked at Philippians 4:13 in my entire life. I'm looking at a little rock that my wife bought me probably 30 years ago. And it says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And that's the truth. That's God's Word. That's the truth. And I've stood on that for ages, for decades. And when I was away from God, I still stood on that. Why? Because I knew that there wasn't nothing in me that could get things done. It had to be through Him. And that's what I want you to understand. That's what got me, you know, me relying upon my goodness and my strength is what really pushed me away from God, because I knew without a shadow of a doubt I was one of the sorriest Christians ever was. Weak. Why? Because I was looking to Stacy. I was taught to just, you know, you got to be good. You got to be good. And yes, you do. But you want to find out how to be good? It's easy. Find God. Start being God conscious instead of sin conscious. Start looking to God and God's Word and allowing Him and believing Him. Romans 8:1 says, for therefore there is therefore no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. I carried a weight of condemnation on me for decades. Why? Because I believed everything the devil ever told me. The lies that he told me. I didn't know any better. But greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Satan wants to lie to you. And when Satan stands up and tells you over and over and over and over and over again, day in and day out, you can't live a Christian life, you might as well quit. Remember one thing. He's a liar and the father of them. And if he's continuously telling you that you can't do something, there's a reason for that. Because he knows without a shadow of a doubt you can, if you ever figure out who you are in Jesus Christ, who you are to God. You're important. You're important. Don't ever believe the devil's lies that says that you're not. I've done it over and over and over again. Had to shut him up and tell him to go away. Why? Because the constant lies. You can't do that. You'll never be able to. I believed that for years. But I've come to the conclusion that Let God be true and every man a liar. And there's so many people that'll stand up and argue, well, yeah, but that's a badge of unbelief. I'm going to believe God's word over and above anything that I can see, hear, feel. I will not stand up and allow carnal things that are going on around me to deter me from believing that my God shall supply all my needs according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And all my needs include health, wealth, strength, spiritual strength, victory, whatever I might need. God said that Philippians 4:19 says, my God shall supply all your needs according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We've got to see that that is truth above, I don't care what the doctors have said, the banks have said, what the stock market has said. I don't care what has been said to you. Believe God's word. If you have been saved, there is therefore now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. If you haven't been saved, believe in your heart, confess with your mouth, and you shall be saved. That's all you have to do. Believe God, confess Him, and you shall be saved. God wants this for everyone. And I'm gonna leave you with this. There's no telling how many people I've heard it from over the years. You know, if God, you know, one of these days God's going to get a hold of me and make me straighten up. And I've got news for you. God's not that way. We're free moral agents. We have control. Genesis 1:26, He gave us dominion over this earth. And we can do whatever we want to. And He's not going to make us do anything. If that is true, that God one day is going to make you straighten up, you're deceived. God is standing with open arms. Revelation, the 3rd chapter, talks about Christ standing at the door and knocking. He said, if any man will open the door, I will come in. He said, you've got to open that. You've got to do that. You've got to make the decision. But I promise you, when you make that decision, He'll come in and He will fellowship with you. He will strengthen you and He will guide you. But it's up to you to let Him. That is where people get it mixed up. God wants to be your best friend. He wants to be there for you, regardless of the position you're in right now. He don't want to leave you there. He won't leave you there if you'll allow Him to help. But it's up to you to come home the way the prodigal son did. It's up to you to believe what God says over and above all things that you see. And if you'll do that, oh, the world that'll open up to you, the strength that you can carry and stand up in the midst of the world crashing down around you and saying, I'm going to believe God over all things. I refuse to fear. Fear is Satan's tool to break you and push you away from God. And it's sad, but it's true that God's been made out to be someone to fear. Now, the word says fear the Lord, but if you'll look at it, that's respect. That's respect. He wants you to understand who He is. But he also wants you to understand that he loves you more than you'll ever realize. He loves you more than you can ever see with your carnal eyes. He sent heaven's best, gave it all that you might be saved. Now, who do you or what do you have your faith in? Have faith in God. Forget about everything else. Put all your faith and your beliefs and your understanding in Him. You say, well, how do I do that? Get in His Word and believe every word of it. Pick up your Bible and consume it the way you would consume a good meal. Savor it and find what God wants you to do in your life. Find what He wants to tell you. And I promise you, He'll guide you to places that you thought you'd never, ever be. Find Him. How do you find Him? In His Word. Faith in God is found in His Word. Seek Him, and you'll find Him. I promise you, you will. God loves you. He cares for you more than you realize. But I promise you, you're far stronger than you'll ever know and understand until you get linked up with God. Jesus says, take my yoke upon me, on you and learn of me. He wants to yoke up with you. He wants to team up with you and take you and strengthen you and guide you. But the decision is yours. Won't you make that decision today? Accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Believe every word that God has written down for your guidance. Allow Him to be Lord over your life, over and above all that you can see. Hey, I'm glad you took the time to tune in. Feel free to get in touch. I like hearing from people who have found out that God's not mad at them and realize that He's there for them in every aspect of life. Don't go another day beat down over your past mistakes. Give them to the Lord and let His Word guide you. God bless you all, and remember, the Lord loves the abortion doctors as much as He loves the babies they're killing. God is no respecter of person. He loves us all, no matter what mistakes we've made.